Okay. So this part is okay? This part is clear? Now, if the helix has n turns, what is the length of the antenna? If the helix has n turns, what is the length of the antenna? NL0. Okay, think about this. NL0, it is the length of the wire. NL0, it is the length of the wire. The length of the antenna is this, which is less than the length of the wire. Length of the antenna is this. Sorry, up to this. This is equal to n times s. Okay. One more, think about that. If it has only one turn, okay, then it will be zero according to you. So this will be NS, okay, length of the antenna. Can we write this? Can we write this? If, now think, if we straighten up the wire, then this becomes like a right triangle. This is equal to L0. This is equal to C or pi D. And this is equal to S. Right? Then we can use the Pythagoras theorem and write this expression. This angle alpha is called the pitch angle of the helix. Pitch angle of the helix. Clearly alpha, that is equal to tan inverse S by pi D equal to tan inverse S by C. Is it okay? Right. Now tell me what happens if alpha is zero. Okay, this is okay. So tell me now. What happens if alpha is zero? No spacing between consecutive turns. S is 0. Yes, you are right. So what happens? Both of you are right. Both of you are correct. So what happens? Then? See the diagram and tell me. I am drawing this also for your help. ID. Yes. NL0 equal to NS. But Pritika, S is 0, right? In this case. This angle is 90 degrees. What happens if alpha is 0? If alpha is 0, clearly, alpha is 0 means what? S is 0? What you just said, if alpha is 0, then S is 0, it's correct. So what happens? All the C equal to L0, okay, right. So, does that give you a hint? C is equal to L0, is correct. So the entire helix becomes a one single loop antenna. The helix is now a loop. Right? So if alpha is 0, then the helix is a loop. Now the other extreme, what happens if alpha is 90 degree? What happens if alpha is 90 degree? D is 0. Yes, absolutely right. So, what happens? Line means, more technical term, linear. Yes, it's a linear wire. It's a monopole, right? Agreed? If alpha is 90 degree, it becomes a monopole, like this. Right? In practice, of course, alpha lies between 0 to 90 degree. 0 and 90 degree are not usually considered. Okay? Second thing, do you remember polarization? If we intelligently design our helix, then we can get circularly polarized waveform radiation from the helix. Okay? So, helical antennas are one of the easiest possible circularly polarized antennas which can give out circular polarization. Okay? There are also some patch antennas, but those are a bit advanced. We did not discuss this in the previous course. Okay? So, helical antennas, it can be used to generate circularly polarized waveforms. We will see how. Okay? Helical antenna, it operates in two different modes. Actually, three. If you see Professor Girish Kumar's lecture, they have also mentioned a third one. Okay? But we will focus on two. First one is the normal mode. Okay. How to excite the normal mode? To have normal mode, the length of the wire should be much less compared to the wavelength. Okay. The length of the wire should be much less compared to the wavelength. The other mode is the axial mode. Okay. For that, the length of the wire will be comparable to the wavelength. For this, lambda naught is the wavelength. Okay, to excite in this mode. Right, let us see the two modes one by one. We will discuss normal mode first. So what is the main criteria to have normal mode, which is given here, that the dimensions of the wire is much less compared to the wavelength. Okay, so what happens? So what happens? So what? So this is a badly drawn helix, sorry about that. This is D, okay. This is S. Clearly, NN0 much less than lambda 0. So, what is the first conclusion? If I say that, what is the first conclusion? Will there be a significant variation of current along the helix? If NL0 is much less than lambda naught, will there be a significant variation of current along the helix? What do you think? Those who have the book, it is page 569. I am giving you the page numbers because the figures in the book are much, much, much better than the figures which I am going. So you understand the question? If lambda naught is much greater than the length of the wire, will there be any significant variation of current along the wire? Yes or no? Let me help you. We have discussed dipole antennas and we have discussed dipole antennas of different lengths. Right? If this is a lambda by 2 dipole antennas, how is the current variation? The current variation is along this. Right? Here at the center, we have the maximum value of current. At the end, we have zero current. This we had seen in when we discussed dipoles. Do you agree? For a dipole antenna? Can you hear me? Okay. And we also have seen the Hertzian dipole, right? And what was the biggest assumption in the Hertzian dipole? The very first standard we considered, that if this is L, if this is L, what we had considered, that L is much less than. So L is in the order of lambda by 50. So there was very, very less. So we had assumed that the current throughout the dipole was almost same. There was no variation of current. As a result, we can very safely take the I0 out of the integration. When we had calculated A theta, remember that if the entire dimensions are very small compared to the wavelength, right, we assume that there is no variation of current along the antenna, right, and we can take the current term out of the integration when we integrate it along the length, right. So don't you think a very similar thing is happening here, that along the length of the antenna there is very, very little variation of current? Correct. So think in this way, can we break up this dipole into a number of, can we break up this helix into a number of dipoles and loops? Like this. This is first loop. Actually, it has drawn the way Balaji. So this is L1, L2, L3, L4, and these are D1, D2, D3, and D4. Is it okay to express the helix into four dipoles and four loops? What do you think? And the dipoles will be Hertzian dipoles, because in this length there is hardly any variation of currents, and the loops will be small loops, because here also there is hardly variation of any current along the loop. D1, D2, D3, D4, yes, we can assume that, because we assume that the helix are perfectly uniform. So we have four dipoles and four loops, right? And we also know the electric field radiated by a dipole and a loop, at least the far fields, right? So we can directly use the expressions. Is it okay? We also know the electric fields radiated by the dipole and the loops. So we can just use those expressions, because we have derived them already in the previous classes. So what is E theta? E theta just now we had seen in the array class. E theta, this is due to the dipole. J eta Ki0 S e to the power of JKR by 4 pi r. This we had seen just now. Only thing is that we have replaced L by S. Can we write this as E theta? This is equal to dipole. Can we write this? Okay. And what about the phi due to the loop? The loop what? E phi equal to eta k square d by 2 square I0 e to the power of minus jkr 4 r sin theta. Okay. Where, what is d? D is this, the diameter of the loop, and s is the length of one turn. This is s and this is d. Okay. Now let us go back a few months and tell me what are the criterions of having a circular polarization. What are the criterias that we can say that a particular EM wave is circularly polarized? We have discussed this when we discussed polarization, the last class of EM theory, before we move to antenna. What were the criterions? If those are satisfied, then we can call that a particular wave is circularly polarized. What are they? Can you recall? Magnitudes will be same. Agreed. Others, del equal to 2 n pi. What is del? Magnitudes will be same. Yes, point taken. And there is another crucial point. Very good. Phase difference should be odd multiple of 90 degree, right? Now see here. Here there is a J. Here there is no J. So the phase difference is already odd multiple of 90 degree. The second criteria you mentioned, that is already satisfied. Agreed? Yes. So whatever happens, the waveform from this normal mode is elliptically polarized. The waveform from this helical antenna is elliptically polarized, right? All of you agree? The waveform that is coming out of this helical antenna is elliptically polarized, the wave. Agreed? What is elliptical polarization? That your second condition is satisfied, what Niloy said, but the first condition may not be satisfied. The phase difference should be 90 degree or multiple 90 degree, but the magnitudes did not be the same. So it is elliptically polarized. So what to do to make the first condition satisfied, the magnitude are same? How to ensure that? Magnitude of E theta should be magnitude of E phi. Let us equate them. K I 0 S e to the power of j k r, that is 1. So let's do sin theta, that is equal to eta k square d by 2 square I 0 sin theta by 4 r. Sin theta gets cancelled. 1 k gets cancelled. I 0 gets cancelled, 4 r gets cancelled. So what do we have? Eta gets cancelled. So s equal to s by pi, that is equal to k d by 2 whole square. Can we write this? Okay, somebody asked a question. No, Arpit. It can be 9. Yes, 0 degree is not case, right? Phase angle is always not 90 degree. Yes, 0 degree will not have a elliptical, I agree. But see, the phase angle is 90 degree. This j, in e theta there is a j, but in e phi there is no j. So the phase angle is always 90 degree. Okay? Arpit, do you agree? See here, e theta there is a j, and in e phi there is no j. So the phase angle 90 degree is always satisfied. The magnitudes may not be equal. That is true. So the elliptical condition for elliptical polarization is always satisfied. The circular polarization condition may or may not be satisfied. Okay? So the phase angle is always 90 degrees due to this J. Right? What is K now? K is 2 pi by lambda. D by 2 square. So that is S equal to 2 lambda naught. Pi square d square by 4. What is this? Or let us make it this way. Okay, fine. Let us make it this way. 1 by 2 lambda naught. Pi square d square. What is this? This is square of circumference. So S equal to 1 by 2 lambda naught. C square, because C equal to pi d. So C equal to square root of 2 lambda naught S. This is the condition for having circular polarization. Any question? If this condition is satisfied, only then we will have circular polarization. If this condition is not satisfied, we will have elliptical polarization. Is it okay? Any questions regarding this mode? And of course, what is tan alpha? Tan alpha was S by pi d, right? So in this case, it will be pi d by lambda naught. Any questions? Any doubts regarding this normal mode? The radiation pattern for this axial mode is given as in this way. This is Balanis pH 58. It's this, like this. Okay. You can please refer to Balanis to see the entire 3D. Obviously, it has a sine theta pattern, right? Because it will be like this because it has a sine theta pattern. Yep. Any questions regarding this mode? This radiation is broadside or end fire? This radiation is broadside or end fire? this radiation is broadside or end fire? These questions are very important for your exam. Right? That for what is the pattern for axial mode of helix, helical antenna, broadside, end fire, or two other things. So these type of questions are very important for your exam point of view. If the exam might be in online mode, rather it's very much expected that the exam will be in online mode. So this type of questions might be asked. Or second question might be, we can find circular polarization for which mode? Normal mode, axial mode, both normal mode and axial mode, or neither. So this type of questions might be asked. So this pattern is broadside or end fire, anyone? Anyone, this pattern is broadside pattern or end fire pattern?
Sir, end fire.
Yes or no? Who said end fire?
Rakesh.
Okay, Rakesh. Why do you think it is end fire? How does the end fire pattern look like? If this is my array, how will the end fire pattern look like, Rakesh? Option A is this green one. And option B is this blue one. So which one is the end fire pattern? The green one or the blue one?
The blue one.
Blue one, very good. So does it look like the blue pattern to you? So this will be broadside. Because the major radiation, this is along the perpendicular to the axis of the helix. If this is the axis of the helix, the major radiation is perpendicular to it. Okay. So at this mode, in the normal mode, the pattern is broadside. However, the next mode, the axial mode, we will see it is actually end fire. Okay. The broadside pattern is okay. Any questions regarding broadside? Actually, 5 minutes are remaining. So we'll do the other pattern, the axial mode and convergence. Any questions regarding broadside pattern? Sorry. Yeah, actually, yes. The normal mode? Okay, so we can conclude.